Well, let's see if they give me a little bit of volume up here. That's wonderful. Well, it's church time. How about that? I came in. I said, all right, choir, let's go. And they said, no, we're off. I said, off? Yeah, we're off, Brian. Brian gave him the night off. And so I don't know what we're going to do, Brother Tommy. We'll just have to
cut it short.
You want me to take night off too? Just take that off. Just take the offering and go home. Take a other's offering and give it to Tommy and go on home. Tommy, he said, preacher, I'm begging for one of those radio sermons. Just like you do on the radio. He said, you don't have any of those 5 or 10 minute sermons left. I said, they ain't there somewhere, but I don't know how well it happened. But all right. Well, it's good to be in church. Amen. We do have some special music lined up tonight. We'll look forward to hearing that later in the service. But let's go ahead and pray. Ask God to have his way in the service once again. All right. Lord Jesus, thank you for what you've done for us today. And Lord, as I have said myself and heard others say, we talk about the heat and how unbearable it is, Lord, sometimes to be outside. And Lord, when I experience that in my own life, hear other people say it, my mind goes to that place called hell. And we cannot imagine what it's like. And Lord, I'm so thankful I'm not going there. I'm so thankful I'm going to a place called heaven. And God, at the same time, my heart's burdened and heavy because I know folks are going there. And Lord, I want to do all I can to warn them, tell them, let them know they don't have to go. So God, help us every time we think about the heat and the humidity to consider we have loved ones and friends who are headed to that place. And God, may we be busy praying for them, trying to see them get saved before it's eternally too late. Now bless the service tonight. May your will be done in every heart and every life. In thy name I pray. Amen and amen. Amen. All right, get a song book out.
All right, let's all stand, turning the hymnals to page number one. Page number one, we'll sing, we'll see, we'll just keep singing until we don't want to sing them no more, okay? We'll probably sing all five. Let's go ahead and stand. My Savior's love, amen. Amen.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wondered how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden, he prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own grief, but sweat drops of blood for mine. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my soul shall ever be. Is my Savior's love for me. In pity angels beheld him, to comfort him in the sorrows he bore for my soul and night. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrow, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. Oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Christ's love for me. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Amen. That's good singing this evening. Amen. All right, let's turn over to page number 43. Page number 43, we'll sing the first, second, and last, Nothing But the Blood. Amen.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my part in this I see. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
On the last,
this is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Amen. You can be seated. Praise God. I like that song about the blood, don't you? All right. I didn't mention it this morning. I left out some of the folks who yesterday congratulate the young adults who with the youth thing. I forgot about those who worked in the kitchen. Got the food ready, Bonnie. You sort of had that thing. You might have done it all by yourself. I don't know. You had some help from other ladies. That's exactly right. Boy, it was really good, too. Yes, sir. It was really, really good. So that's a real blessing there. All right. Don't forget now, this coming Wednesday, we'll be having our monthly supper at 5:45. Hope you'll be here for that. This morning, we had planned on hearing the Pastor Pryor kids sing, but some of those are sick. So they'll do that next Sunday, Lord willing. And then we need some help. Bible school fellas, sign up. Go back there and look where you can help us out. Your main thing is just doing the crafts. And there's all kind of craft projects. You can get your wife to pull them up on your internet if you can't handle that kind of stuff. All kind of things you can do to help the boys. And that's just 45 minutes. That's all I need each day that week, okay? Now, some of the ladies have signed up. We still have some openings there for ladies. So don't wait the last minute now. Go ahead and do it now. Just go ahead and sign up. By next Sunday, if we don't have any signed up, I'm just going to write names down. I'm just going to write names down, and I'll just include everybody, okay? And so if you'll do that, it'll be a big blessing, big help, and 10 things every little boy and girl teenager needs in their life, 10 things. I'll give those to you. I plan on doing it. I'll post them Wednesday, so those of you who will be teaching, and if you want to go that way. But all right, we're going to have a great time. It's always a great time with the kids for Bible school, so help us out with that, all right? Well, July is not really a busy month. It doesn't look like on the church calendar. June was packed. July is not full. Many of you are going to go off for the week of the 4th or day of the 4th or whatever. And just be careful everywhere you go. Remember, you're a child of God everywhere you go. Boy, everybody should have heard that Sunday school lesson this morning. You will not go anywhere without Jesus if you're saved. So don't carry me into places he wouldn't go. Don't carry me into places he wouldn't go. Okay, and don't do anything he wouldn't do. You say, preacher, great day. What am I supposed to do? Just be filled with the Spirit. That's what you're supposed to do. And all right, but anyway, I'm looking forward to the summer And it's hard to believe June is just went right by, hasn't it? Just bam. And for those of you reading your Bible through, we have the daily Bible reading up here with the Baptist brother up here. Get yours and enjoy that, okay? All right. Somebody asked me this morning about the ponders from the preacher. Where do those come from? Most of them just come from me. Now, some I've heard over the years, and I've written down. I didn't write down where I got it from. But most of them, Lord just gives to me, here, there, and yonder. And I write them down. And just like yesterday at the youth meeting, I got a good sermon title. And I'm working on it already. Somebody says, you think you perfect. Well, now I found out I am perfect in some things. In some things. What is that? Well, I'll tell you one day, real soon in a message, how perfect. If you're saved, if you're a Christian, you have some perfection in you. Okay, but it's not in yourself. Okay? I'll just go ahead and wipe that out right now. We're not perfect in ourselves, but we do have some perfection in us. Hey, amen. I can't wait to preach it when the Lord lays it all together.
I thought you had it ready for the day.
You thought I had it ready for the day? Well, I'm working on it. I'm working on it, okay? And I'll probably preach it when you're not here.
Probably.
All right. Okay. Let's have another good song, okay?
All right, you can remain seated on this one. Turn to page number 91. Page number 91, what a day that'll be. Amen?
Right.
Amen.
Right.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky. No more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore. On that happy golden shore, what a day, glorious day that will be. Oh, what a day that will be, when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more party over there. And forever I will be, oh, with the one who died for me. Oh, what a day, glorious day that will be. Oh, what a day that will be. Oh, when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. Oh, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Alright, we've got some special singing. We'll get one of them up here. Everybody needs to get ready now. Who's singing first?
Who?
Brian's going to go first. Alright, where's Brian at? Make your way up here as quick as you can, Brian, okay? He sang this song yesterday, I believe. I'm telling you what, it really blessed my heart. I'm glad he decided to sing it again tonight. I don't know if he decided or somebody decided for him. Lots of requests for it. A lot of requests for it, okay? And all right, well, it's good to get a request for singing, and nobody requesting your preaching, but just requesting us sing.
I have to say, yesterday was a real blessing. That was actually the first youth meeting that I've been to here. The first one we had, I wasn't able to attend, but yesterday was great. Both of the messages that was preached was right on, stuff that I needed. But the title of the song is When Mercy Walked In. I stood in the courtroom, the judge turned my way. It looks like you're guilty. Now what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor. I have no defense. But that's when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand. God's saving grace, the blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiven when mercy walked in. I stood there and wondered, how could this be, that someone so guilty had just been set free? My chains were broken, I felt born again, the moment when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand. God's saving grace, the blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiven when mercy walked in. Oh, the blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiven when mercy walked in.
That's it. Got a group of ladies.
Got a group of ladies gonna sing. You know, when I first got saved, I didn't know anything about mercy. I'd heard about amazing grace, but I didn't know anything about mercy. And all those other words that we rejoice in. I've enjoyed learning all these things over the year about, you know, mercy. Not getting what you deserve. Isn't that something? And grace is getting what you don't deserve. All right, ladies, come on up, whoever you are. There's Ruth, she's singing. Oh, she's playing, okay. All right, Miss Nancy, Joanne, Barbara. Oh, boy, amen.
Yes, sir, come on up, girls. Okay. Now get close to the microphone. It will not bother.
Control.
Some more of that down the road.
Yes, sir.
Real soon, too, okay?
Yes, sir.
Get Brian to sing again. And this Brian sang yesterday, did a superb job. And I'm thankful. You ought to be ready all the time. So the preacher ought to be ready to call on you and just come sing.
Yeah.
So next week, I say, you four ladies go sing a song. Just sing that again. Okay? Get together and practice and work on some more. Okay? I mentioned grace and mercy a few moments ago. I don't know if you remember this, but I think it maybe a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years ago, I preached Sunday morning on mercy and how God has extended his mercy to us day in and day out and not getting what you deserve. Sometimes we deserve a spiritual spanking or we deserve being corrected and punished. Well, if God did that, we'd be in trouble, wouldn't we? Aren't you glad for his mercy? Well, we got home that day at the house, was eating dinner, and I don't know what was going on, but Noah was misbehaving. And she kept telling her, Noah, behave, behave, behave. And finally, she had enough of it. She says, Noah, if you don't straighten up, I'm going to have to give you a spanking. You understand me? And he said, Nana, please show mercy. When she looked at me and said, what am I going to do? I said, I don't know. You better show mercy. That's all I can say. And goes to show you sometimes kids pay attention. You might not think they listen, but sometimes they just pick up on a little something and it gets their attention. And they use it to their advantage too. I think you and I do that same thing sometimes, don't we? All right, well, yesterday at the youth meeting, we had a young preacher here all the way from North Carolina. And weren't able at the time to give him a love offering, so we're going to receive that tonight. And Dusty Davis, is that correct? Brother Davis? Huh?
That's it.
And so he and his wife and two kids came all the way down. And so I said, Brother Dusty, we're going to send you a love offering. Oh, don't worry about that, Brother Baker, blah, blah. I said, no, we're going to do that. I ain't got it for you right now, but we'll give it to him. So I started just giving him a pen and a flashlight and said, go on down the road, but I figure I might put that in an envelope too. So we'll do that for them tonight. That's an awful long way to come. But I tell you what, he sure did some great preaching. Amen. So we'll send it to him with a little nice thank you note. And so let's give tonight. Okay? All right. Let's sing a couple of verses.
Amen. All right. Let's all stand once again. Turn to page 157. 157. We'll sing the first and the last before we start singing. I was picking at some of the folks when they was coming in. Y'all go ahead and stand up. And I was trying to get some more singing for tonight, so Robbie come in. And I told him, I said, Robbie, I said, we're looking for some more specials tonight. And so he started pointing out. I said, tell you what, we're going to start a duet or a trio with him and Chris, and we got to find one or two more. But we're going to call them the Bald Eagles is what we're going to do. But I think if we just do the duet, we'll have Robbie and Chris, and we'll call them Mr. Clean, Mr. Clean. Mr. Clean, Mr. Clean. Yeah, so we'll do that. So y'all work on that, okay? All right, first and last, 157. Amen.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus fainted all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete,
yes.
Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Amen.
Well, I forgot to do it this morning, but we had gotten some offerings in the mail from last week from three different people. One was one of our widows, not able to come, so she sent her tithes and offerings in. Then one from another member who lives off, and then a family down in Florida sent offerings. And I forget what the offering was this morning, about $3,600. So there'll be about another $1,200 added to that. Isn't that something? Isn't that good? Praise the Lord. I'm glad God knows what we need, able to supply. All right. Well, let's be a blessing to Brother Davis and his family. Nice thank you. Send him a good offering. Let's pray. Now, Lord Jesus, once again, we come before you recognizing that we're just nothing without you. We're empty, void without you. So may we every day come to that conclusion that we got to have you, and you plainly told us that without you we could do nothing, and truly we can't. But with you, there's no telling what we could do in your name. So in your name tonight, we receive this offering. And Lord, we pray it'll be sufficient for some need this family may have in their life. And I pray you'll bless it. In thy name I ask it. Amen. Miss Ruth, that's a real blessing there. Let's get our Bibles out tonight. And is the PA system on? Am I on? Am I on, Brother Rick? Turn me up, Doc. Amen. Don't turn me off. That's his life's ambition, is to cut me off. All right. Oh, yeah. I was thinking once again why it's been off and on my heart all day about this morning's Sunday school lesson about the Holy Spirit. And if the devil can, he will get you. He'll get you away from the influence of the Holy Spirit. He really will. And if you get away from the influence of the Holy Spirit, I'm telling you, no telling what you might say or do. I'm serious. And you wonder how some saved people can do some things. It's because they're walking afar off from the Holy Spirit. I mean, they're saved, but you sometimes wouldn't hardly know it. And you ask them, well, why you do that? Why you say that? Well, that's the way I am. Well, that's not the Holy Spirit talking there. And so it's always very important that you as a saved person, you rely on the Holy Spirit. All right, let's get our Bibles out. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm going to read a verse here and use a particular word tonight for our message, okay? 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 6. 1 Timothy 4:6. If thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good what? Minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained. I want to preach tonight on this thought, being a good minister. Being a good minister. If you write these verses down and go home and read them tonight, it'd help you. But over in the book of Joshua, we referred to him lately. In chapter 24, verse 13, we find there in Exodus 24, 13, that Joshua was called the servant of Moses. And that word servant is the word minister. Matter of fact, it uses the word minister. And we find also in Joshua 1:1, we find there also that he was a minister to Moses. Now, what does it mean? What does the word minister mean? Well, let me give you a definition. It means to give, or supply, or furnish. It means to be a servant or a helper. So when we look at those definitions the Bible gives us of a minister, a servant, a helper, to give, to supply, or to furnish. Now we find this also over in the book of 2 Corinthians 9:10, Ephesians 4:29. As a matter of fact, when you think about the word minister, what do you normally think of? You think about a pastor or a preacher, amen? Well, he's our minister. And I thought about this. Often the pastor is called minister. And that's a good word. But every pastor should strive to be a good minister. In other words, a servant, a helper, one who gives, one who helps supply, one who helps furnish. So every preacher, every pastor should be a good minister. The same application is found in the position of deacon. In other words, every deacon should be a good minister. Years and years ago, I had a deacon to want to confront me about the deacons. He said, we don't have any authority, preacher. I thought deacons were supposed to have authority. We don't have any authority. And what are we supposed to do? Well, I just sort of looked at him and I said, really and truly, if you get right down to it, you do have no authority. Have absolutely no authority at all. Okay? Now that goes contrary to modern day churches. Okay? When it gets right down to it, a deacon is to minister under the authority of the pastor. Under the authority. They're not to be the authority over the pastor, but under the pastor. What is their ministry? To minister, to help out, to do. Matter of fact, one preacher said, deliver groceries. In other words, take care of the widows. That's where they come from. That's what the position is. But you know what? I don't want to belittle that position. Being a deacon is very, very important. And I think when a church gets to a certain level and the pastor needs help, he needs to get him some good deacons. Amen? Good qualified men. Good qualified men, not women. But men, okay? All right. So, but anyway, so a good pastor, a pastor should be a good minister. A deacon should be a good minister, okay? But let's go a step further, okay? Save people, since Jesus, he said, I come not to be ministered to, but I came to minister. That's what Jesus said. And Jesus told his apostles, he said, now, if you're going to be if you're going to be great, you're going to have to be a servant. You're going to be a minister. And so if we who are saved, if we're going to call ourselves Christian, we must be like who? Christ. So with that same thought in mind, every saved person should be Christ-like. Amen? Amen. So every saved person is to be in the ministry. Everybody here, if you're saved, under my voice, you, if you're saved,
You are to be in the ministry. You are to be some type of minister. That doesn't mean that you're going to pastor a church. Doesn't mean that you're going to be in some time full-time Christian service. But if you're saved, God expects you to be in the ministry. We find that in Acts chapter 4, verse 32 through 36. If you go read those verses, it says the people, the church there at Jerusalem, they were so of such one accord and had such a bond that those who had helped those who did not have. Those who were in need, those needs were met by those who could help meet that need. What did they do? They ministered one to another. Some even took, sold their land and sold their possessions that the poor could have. So there's a perfect example there of that church being a church with a good ministry. Some years ago in 2011, I was reading a message by Dr. Shelton Smith. He's the editor of the Sword of the Lord. And Brother Smith gave in his little article there some things about the minister. And though it was applied to the pastor, I got to looking at that and I said, you know what? Those things that he said about, and I, when I looked at them and I said, boy, I need every one of those in my life as a pastor. Every one of them. There wasn't a one I didn't need. There were some I didn't have. I said, I need that right there. So I got to looking and pondering that, and I said, you know what? These are some things that every Christian needs in their life. So if you're going to be a good minister, we need some wives in the ministry. We need some husbands in the ministry. We need some of you young people in the ministry. We even need the children in the ministry. Amen. Let's set a good example for those that will follow us of being good ministers. And when I got to thinking about it, I want to give these to you as quickly as I can. There's several of them. I'm not going to tell you how many because you would have a heart attack. Okay? And it's a page full. But one page. Not two, not three. So if you're going to be a good minister, one thing you're going to have to do is walk steadfastly. That we'll write these down. Walk steadfastly. Now, there's some running in the ministry. But let me ask you a question. Before a child can run, it must learn how to do what? Walk. So if you're going to be a good minister, you're going to have to learn to walk steadfastly. That means that you're going to have to learn to walk in a steadfast way. In other words, walk with some stability in your life. You ever seen a small child learning how to walk? They just sort of, they're back and forth, they're wobbling. What's the problem? They're not stable on their feet. They're just learning how to walk. And with each passing day, that child who's learning how to walk, they get some steadfastness in their walk. It's amazing how we parents sometimes we want to see our children crawl, and then we say, boy, I can't wait till they walk, and they get to walking, and when they get to walking, they get in everything. Then we say, boy, I wish they was crawling again. But if you're going to be a good minister, you've got to learn to walk steadfastly. You've got to walk with some stability in your life. What's wrong today in so many people's lives, saved people, is they have very little stability in their life. Boy, I look at our congregation here. We don't have a great big congregation numerically. But we do, I believe with all my heart, we have got some folks in this church who set a good example of steadfastness in their life. I mean, they've got a good steadfast marriage. They've got a good steadfast relationship with God. And you can see it in their life. Aren't you glad of that? Amen. That we have some examples here of steadfastness in people's lives. And I don't just see it in people who are up in years. I see it in some of our young people. And I hope and pray that these young people will maintain that steadfastness in their life. Because once you get that walk steadfast and that walk settled, then you'll be able to run down the road with it somewhere. So if you're going to be a good minister, you're going to have to walk steadfastly. Get your spiritual feet under you. Number two, you're going to have to stand uprightly. Now, I'm not talking about physically, but stand for what you believe. Stand for what you know is right. Have some convictions about you. Stand uprightly. And the only way you can stand uprightly is to know what you believe. I'm amazed when you ask some people today what they believe, and they'll say, about what? And I say, what do you believe about church attendance? I'm for it. You know, sometimes a lot of people think that they, because they talk about religion, that makes them spiritual. But the average saved person has no idea what it means to stand uprightly and live for God. They have no convictions. They don't know much about the Bible. So stand for what you believe and don't back down from anybody anyway. Stand uprightly. Number three, run relentlessly. Relentlessly. Say that real fast, okay. Run in such a way. In other words, Paul said that he'd run his race, he'd finish his course, and he used the word run. And so run relentlessly. In other words, run with no idea of turning back. I was watching a little video of some kids playing flag football. And so I watched this little boy. He had that ball, boy, and he's running toward the end zone. They're after him. Well, he gets right close to the goal line and turns around and goes back the other way. But he gets almost to that goal line, and they're hollering, wrong way, right? He turns around and goes back, and he gets another goal. In other words, he did it three times. Now he was running relentlessly. He finally got it right. In other words, there was no stopping him. You are to so run your race, and as Paul said, no looking back. If you're going to run the race relentlessly, you've got to keep your eyes focused on what's ahead. Amen. The finished product. Amen. So if you're going to be a good minister, you can't live in the past. I don't care. You can't live in past victories. You can't live in past defeats. You got to run and run with no looking back. Number four, if you're going to be a good minister, if I'm going to be a good minister, we got to learn to love deeply. I said love deeply. It's sad but true, but most people, their love is very shallow. Very shallow. Their love sometimes is based on, you know, if I've been good to you, you got to be good to me. If I blessed you, you got to bless me. That's not the kind of love I'm talking about. The kind of love that runs deep is the kind of love that loves those who are not able to love back or might not even love back. The kind of love that loves the unlovable. The kind of love that has sometimes have to put up with some things. Are you listening to me? Learn to love deeply. We have so much shallow love. You need to every so often, about once a week, you need to read 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And when you read that chapter 13, verses 4 through 8, here's what it says in verse 8. Love never faileth. Love never does fail. Amen. The type of love that God says we should have, it never fails. Wow, that's the kind of love we need. If you're going to be a good minister, ladies and gentlemen and children, you've got to love deeply. And the only way you can do that is in the love of Christ. Amen? Yeah. How about this? You not only got to do that, but you got to obey willingly. You've got to learn to obey willingly. I was thinking about the example of Joshua and others in the Bible. And the Bible says that Joshua, the minister to Moses. And then it says Joshua, the servant to Moses. Here's the picture that it gives there. Moses is God's man. And it's almost like Joshua was so close to Moses and so loved him. It didn't matter what Moses said. Joshua said, Moses could say, Joshua, do this. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's amazing. If you and I would get to the point in our life that we would obey God willingly. Think about this. Lord, thy will be done. You know what a servant is? He's just a servant. A real servant, a bond servant, will obey willingly. It does not matter what their master says to do, they'll do it. Jesus is our Lord and Master. Do you obey him willingly? When he nudges you to do something, do you do that? Do you argue with him? Do you fuss with him? Can you see a loyal servant telling his master, I won't do that. That's not my job. And the master who has given him his liberty and taken care of him, and the master says, don't you know I love you? Don't you know I'll give you anything. I'm everything I got's yours. And here's what I want you to do. A loyal servant obeys willingly. Lord, thy will be done. Isn't that what Jesus said to the Father? Thy will be done. So if you're going to be a good minister of the Lord Jesus Christ, you got to obey willingly. How about this? You must pray pointedly. You must pray pointedly. Get to the point of the matter in prayer. This is not how we're supposed to pray. This is not how you do it. Now, Father, you know all those folks that are sick. Just help them all. Father, you know where my kids are. Just do something with them. Father, you know where my grandkids are. Protect them. That's not the way you're supposed to pray. Now, Father, you know what I need. Just give it to me. No. If you're going to be a good minister, you must pray pointedly. Get rid of the shotgun and get the rifle out. Father, here's my need. Father, here's their need. Would you help them with this? Would you meet this need for them? Would you give them this in their life? Pray, if you're going to minister, do it pointedly. Get right to the point. Make, in other words, you say, well, God already knows. I know he knows, but our God wants us to ask him exactly. I cannot tell you the value of you when you pray, get to the point. I mean, even when somebody calls on you to pray, get to the point. If the pastor says, Brother Tommy, would you ask God to bless the offering that we're going to take? What's he supposed to do? Bless the offering. Not the missionaries, not the Sunday school department, but bless the offering. Pray pointedly. Is there anything wrong with praying for the missionaries? No, we should do that. Anything wrong with praying for the Sunday school class? No. But that's not what he's praying. Pray for the offering. God bless this offering. Help us. So anyway, pray pointedly. Get to the point. First of all, you got to pray. How about this? Number 7, study carefully. If you're going to be a good minister, study carefully. Now listen to this statement. Few people study the Bible. And many who study the Bible study to correct it. You don't study the Bible to correct it. You study the Bible so it can correct you. You don't study the Bible to try to explain it away. You study the Bible to try to explain it to other people. Study your Bible. It's more than just reading daily Bible reading. Study your Bible. I mean, put aside those things that have no relevance to your spirituality. I mean, cut off your radio. Cut off your television. Get off your computer. Get off your phone and get your Bible out and study the Word of God. If you're going to be a good minister. A good minister. Wow. I gave my wife some information about Susanna Wesley, and she began to read some things about her. She said to me, she said, you had it wrong about her children. I said, what? She said, she had 19 children. And she was one of 24. she began this information about Sister Wesley. She says, I'm gonna read about her and study about her. If you're going to be a good minister, you got to do some studying. Study the Word of God. Study people who live for God. Study for people who honored God. Mold your studying after those who are godly people. Amen? So study carefully. The next one is teach truthfully. Teach truthfully. Well, Brother Baker, I'm not a teacher. If you're a parent, you are. If you're a grandparent, you are. Could I say to you, if you're saved, you are. Teach truthfully. What would happen if somebody at work asked you how they can know they could be saved? Could you tell them? Let me ask you a question. If somebody where you work or in your neighbor were to ask you, why do you go to church on Sunday night? Could you tell them anything? Could you teach them anything? Now, I'm not talking about you expounding the scriptures like some theologian, but could you teach them anything? So study carefully and teach truthfully. Listen now, few people study the Bible, and because of that, a truth must be in you. You cannot teach truthfully if truth is not in you. You've got to have it in you before you can teach it. Let's go ahead. Not only that, but you gotta speak softly. If you're going to be a good minister, you're going to have to get rid of that harshness and that brassness that you may have. That attitude of I know and you don't. You got to learn to speak softly. Now, I don't mean whisper. I don't mean. You see, listen, this is very important. Speaking softly is not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of strength. Child misbehaves. And the parent says, all right, boy, you hear me and you hear me well. You do it again, you're going to get it. Scares the child to death. Terrifies them. That's weakness. Strength, watch this. Strength humbles yourself. You get down to that child's level and you say, son, I love you. And I love you enough to tell you that if you continue to do that, you're gonna end up getting a spanking. I don't want to, I don't desire to. Do you understand me, son or daughter? I love you, but I will spank you if necessary. There's a difference. You see, screaming and hollering and threatening doesn't do anything for the situation. You must learn to speak softly. It's a sign of strength. You think Jesus was weak when he died on the cross? Do you think he was weak? The Bible says a legion of angels were waiting, ready to come and rescue him. But he didn't need a legion of angels. He could have rescued himself. You see, speaking softly is a sign of strength, not weakness. Weakness is when you try to show your strength. So you must learn to speak softly. The next one talks about this. If you're going to be a good minister, you've got to witness fervently. Witness fervently. Never be ashamed of Christ. Witness fervently. In other words, when you're out in the world, where you work or go to school, or where you live, I mean, be ready to be a witness. Amen? Be ready to be a witness. Don't have the idea, well, you know, if the opportunity arises, I'll try to say something. No! Hey, make the opportunity. Create the opportunity to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, one of the evidences of being saved is that you'll not be ashamed. So witness fervently. What's missing in today's church is that fervent witness of the Lord Jesus Christ in a person's life. When's the last time somebody saw Jesus really in you because you witnessed to them? How about this? You must not only witness fervently, you must give generously. You must learn, if you're going to be a good minister, you must give generously. Give, listen, give what God gives to you. Learn to give what God gives to you. Whatever God gives you, that's something that maybe you can give, and you can give it, don't give it sparingly. You learn to give generously. I'm so thankful that God has given us, I believe, a church family as a whole who does give generously. If there's any tightwads or skinflints in the church, I don't know of them. I'll be honest with you. If we had somebody who was afraid to give, I don't think they'd stay in this church very long. Because we all the time just giving stuff away. I mean, just last Sunday night, we spent over $3,000 just trying to help somebody. Aren't you glad of that? Don't ever be afraid to give what God tells you to give. Because if He tells you to give it, I promise you, you'll be rewarded for it. Maybe here, maybe later. So if you're going to be a good minister, give generously. Now, the next one, how about this? You're going to have to learn to deal honestly. Deal honestly. No cheating or lying in your business. Deal honestly. You keep everything above the table in your dealings. This undermining stuff, oh my soul. And sometimes I think that sometimes preachers can be the worst lot about not dealing honestly. The church has a credit card, and I have it. Matter of fact, it's such a good card that the more we use it, the more we get out of it. They pay us to use it. Are you with me? They pay us to use the card. About a week or two ago, I was in line, and it was backed up, and I had some personal stuff and church stuff, and so when I was there, I said, just put it all on this, and I'm talking to myself, and I'll just reimburse the church. Well, I got busy and forgot about it, but there was somebody else didn't forget about it. You know who he was? Can you tell me who he was? Holy Spirit. So I know where I'm in the room. I said, Sherry! She said, what? I said, write a check for a certain amount and make it out to church. She said, what's that for? And I told her what it's for. And so you got to deal honestly. Deal honestly. Some years ago, many years ago, I don't know why this guy said this, and he said about this. He said, do you pay taxes? Do you pay taxes on all the church does for you? He asked me that question. I don't know why. I said, yeah, do you? He said, well, take it out of my check. I didn't ask you that. What God gives you extra, do you tithe on that too? I said, if God gives me something extra besides what the church gives me, I tithe on that. Or try to find out what it's worth. If you give me a Bible, a brand new Bible, that's a gift. If I'm going to deal honestly with God, I'm not going to ask you what the Bible costs. I said, that looks like a $30 Bible. I'll tithe on that Bible. Are you honest? You're not going to be honest with God. You think you'll be honest with anybody else? Back when we had our Christian school, on the application it had, do you tithe? Do you tithe? One guy said, why is that on there? I said, well, if you'll rob God, you'll rob us. And by the way, on the application, we asked the preacher, if there wasn't members here, we asked the preacher, does this member tithe? They didn't tithe, we didn't take them. Well, we got to get going here. I hit a knot there. Deal honestly. How about this? Work diligently. The Bible says, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with all thy what? Might. Work diligently. Do what you're supposed to do. How about this? Correct gently. Correct gently. Now, why is it so important that you, nobody, not just with children, but maybe where you work, when you have to correct somebody, how do you do that? Do you do it gently? Now, here's why. Just two simple words. Consider yourself. When you had to be corrected, don't you want it to be done gently? Don't you want to be done with the right spirit? So consider yourself when you have to correct somebody. How about this? Decide wisely. If you're going to be a good minister, decide wisely. Decisions can make or break you. If you're going to be a good minister, you must decide wisely. When I use the word wisely, that means you seek wisdom from God. You have some type of counsel that you can get from people. Do you have any Christian counselors? What? Yeah. I mean, the Bible tells us that it's wise. It's foolish not to have some counselor. Somebody can help you. Not that they're going to make the decision, but maybe they can point you. And so decide wisely, because decisions can make and break you. How about this? Administer fairly. Administer fairly. Here's the same two words while ago with correct gently. Consider yourself when you administered fairly. You see, if you're not fair with people, they won't be fair with you. Do you want folks to be fair with you? Do you? If you're going to be a minister and you're going to help people, encourage people, you must administer fairly. That's one reason why they got those early deacons, because the widows wasn't getting what they needed. It wasn't being administered fairly. How about this? Advise sparingly. Advise sparingly. Listen to this now. You only advise when you can with no guesswork. Advise sparingly. If you're going to be a good minister, advise sparingly. If we're not careful, here's what we say to people sometimes. Well, here's what I think about it. Here's what I do. And nobody's asked for that comment, for what you think about it. Here's what I think about it. Advise sparingly, only when you can or should, with no guesswork. If Brother Sam comes to me and says, "Preacher, I need some advice. Maybe you can help me." So he asks my advice, and he gives me what he. If I am going to be honest, if I don't know, I'm just saying, "Sam, I don't know nothing about that." Because if I don't, I don't. So how can I advise him if I don't know anything about it? So advise sparingly. Only when you're asked to, it covers your area, and do it sparingly. You're going to be a good minister, because as you minister to people, if you're not careful, as you minister and help people, you'll see their problem, you'll see the situation, and what you want to do is try to correct it for them. If you're not careful, you'll say, "Well, try this." Try. So advise sparingly. Make sure the Holy Spirit's in it when you advise somebody. Okay? Are we headed anywhere with this? We're talking about being good ministers. I'm almost through, praise God. Wait patiently. If you're going to be a good minister, wait patiently. I heard this years ago, wrote it down. There's some great truth to it. When in doubt, don't. When in doubt, don't. Now, don't let that mess up your faith. But if you're doubting something, hey, wait. Better to wait than to make a decision. You don't know how it's going to turn out. When in doubt, don't. And don't let that mess up your faith, though, okay? Because you need faith. Walk and live by faith. But wait patiently. Believe in the Lord and trust Him. How about this? Serve faithfully. If you're going to be a good minister, you must serve faithfully. Do what you're supposed to do. That's it. Do what God tells you to do and what you're supposed to do and serve faithfully. Bible school's coming up. We need some servants. We need some ministers. Well, Brother Baker, I'm not good at Bible school. Didn't say you had to be good. I don't know how to do it. Ask God to help you do it. Give me some ideas. Ask God to give you some ideas. Serve faithfully. Consider the fact that you're going to have some little boys and girls or whatever age group you may have, and you're going to be with them and you're going to work on a project. Don't look at that type of task as it's something that is just impossible. Well, Lord, you could put me in there with them little boys and girls or whatever group you may be with, and God, I can be a servant to them. A lady just passed away, and I won't give you her name. I preached her funeral. Her kids came here many years ago, rode the buses as little boys and girls, and when they got to be teenagers, they sort of got out of church and went their way. And their mother just passed away recently. They asked me to come and preach to a funeral for the mother, and I did. And here's what the boy said to me. He said, "Brother Baker, I remember when we rode the bus and we came to Sunday school and came to Bible school." He says, "Looking through my old stuff in my room that had been stuck in a corner." Here's what he said. He said, "I found the Bible that Mr. Mixon gave me in Bible school." I said, "Why'd you get that Bible?" He said, "He told us if we finished our project, he'd give us all a new Bible." He didn't know what, in other words, I asked him, I said, "Well, what was the project?" He said, "I don't know, but I remember getting that Bible." You can serve faith. You can be a minister. And you can minister to old people, young people. I mean, you can be in it. Amen. And then here's the last thing. If you're going to be a good minister, you must live joyfully. You must live joyfully. Preacher, how can that be? How can I live joyfully? Well, to me, I'm not saying this is the only answer, but here's what I can come to. If you are going to be a good minister and live joyful, in other words, live with such a joy that it's real and it's genuine, here's what you got to do. It comes from being contented. Godly contentment brings great what? Gain. Live joyfully, and the only way you can, it comes from contentment. Lord, you have blessed me with this and this and this. Contentment is not the idea, boy, I want this and I want that. I got to have this, I got to have that. Contentment says, Lord, you know my needs and you're going to supply. And Lord, you know my heart and what I may want. Do you know what? If you learn to live contently, God will give you more. But if you live just to get, you might get it, but it won't come from God. Learn, if you're going to be a good minister, live joyfully. That means as you help people and serve people and honor people, and hey, when you go to work, the job you work on, do you do it joyfully or begrudgingly? Well, I'm here, I'll tell you what. Kids want to go to school with joy. Most of them don't. I didn't. The only joy I got in school was recess and P.E. And 3 o'clock. That's when the bell rang. The joy I had. Live joyfully. There's so many pastors who are pastoring churches and they do it grudgingly. Oh, these people, they ain't none of them doing living right. And I preach and they go and they gripe and bellyache. And could it be that he's that way too? Live joyfully if you're going to be a good minister. I would add one last thing. It'd be just applied to me. For the preacher to be a good minister, he must preach boldly. The Bible says, "Lift up thy voice like a trumpet. Cry aloud." And so that's required in a preacher. Now, he can teach, do all these other things, but if he's going to be a preacher, he must preach boldly what God lays upon his heart. Amen. Well, what about it? You're going to be a, did you write any of these down? Or you got a perfect memory? Which ones are you going to remember? I wrote them down. I wrote these down. 2011. I started saying 1911. That wouldn't work, would it? I wrote these down in 2011, 5 years ago. Be a good minister. Be a good servant. Honor God with your life. Let other folks see that in you. And God will bless you for it. And your life, it will bring stability to your life. It'll bring contentment to your life. Get outside your shell. Get outside of yourself. And let God use you. You can do it no matter what age you are. If you're in good health or bad health, God can still use you. Amen. Well, let's pray. Father, thank you tonight for the message. Lord, it has really spoken to my heart once again. And God, I want to be a good minister. Not necessarily a good preacher, though I want that too. But Lord, I want to be a good servant. I want to be a good helper to those, dear God, that I come into contact with. I want to do a better job at it too. So Lord, please enable me to do that. And I pray for the church family, Lord, that those who are serious about this matter, Lord, will take it to heart and strive to be in the ministry for the glory of God. Now bless the invitation. Once again, may your will be done in the lives of your people. In thy name I pray, amen and amen. Let's stand to our feet. Good minister listens to the Holy Spirit, minds what he says. Doesn't mind an altar call. Matter of fact, he looks forward to it. Good ministers. He said, Timothy, be a good minister. Joshua was a good minister. David was a good minister to King Saul. Yeah. Be ready to serve. Lord, what would you have me to do? Thy will be done. If I can do it, I'll do it. Amen, amen. Well, I trust you'll have a great week, and we'll gather here again on Wednesday night. It's for our Wednesday church supper. Yes, ma'am. Bonnie, you want to say something? Okay. Amen. So that was a quartet of ladies. But that's a good minister. Amen. Oh boy. You weren't saved to be you and I were not saved to be ministered to. We were saved to minister. Now watch this. But there will come a day in your life you will need the ministry to come to you. There'll come a day that you'll need help. You'll need a phone call. You'll need a visit. You might need some assistance. And so you get what you reap. You get what you sow and you reap it. Amen. All right. Well, God bless you. Be careful going home. Adios, amigo. See you.